Yeah, welcome to the first lecture of the course Artificial Intelligence. So this is the primary textbook which we will be following, Artificial Intelligence, A Modern Approach by Stuart Russell and Peter Norvig. May not be this edition, a latest edition is available. And this is one of the reference book, Artificial Intelligence by Alain Rich and Kevin Knight. There are also many other reference books we will be using, so that will be mentioned in the handout. So we'll be discussing about handout sometimes later, maybe by the end of this week. Fine, so let us start with the introduction to the course. So the term artificial intelligence, it's a very fascinating field. Why it is fascinating? It is fascinating because we are trying to create intelligent agents, or we are trying to create some entity which can reproduce intelligence, right? So in the world, a man, we call ourselves as Homo sapiens, that is man the wise, because man is unique, humans are unique because of their intelligence. So many philosophers and great scientists from since the beginning of human race, people are trying to understand like how human mind works or how human brain works, so basically there are philosophers like Aristotle or Galileo, everybody, they try to understand how human mind works. So intelligence itself is a complex topic. Like we should have the clarity, like what is intelligence, then only we can reproduce an intelligent machine. So artificial intelligence is not just concerned with understanding intelligence. So philosophy is concerned with understanding intelligence. So it is saying like how intelligence work, or how an intelligent person behaves, or how an person who is not intelligent, how he acts. So basically philosophy is more of psychology. It also involves some aspect of psychology, right? There we only try to study how a human mind works or how a human brain works. But in artificial intelligence, it is not just studying or understanding it. It is beyond that. So more than understanding, after understanding, we should be able to take that knowledge and we should be able to give it to a machine or to a device and make it intelligent. So it is not just concerned with understanding intelligence, but it is concerned with building intelligent entities. So AI is concerned with the design of intelligence in an artificial device. So how are we going to import intelligence to an artificial device or an electronic device, right? So that's the whole question. But to answer this question, we have to touch upon so many fields, lot of background work is required. Because first we should know what is intelligence, and then we should know how intelligence can be represented, and then how we can make these agents or the devices to act in an environment, in a real world environment. How can we make these devices to exhibit intelligent behavior? So this term AI was coined by McCarthy in the year 1956 in a conference. Here there are two things. There are two key terms in the definition of AI. These are intelligence and artificial device. So, as we have already discussed, intelligence, first we should have the clarity like what is intelligence? What is intelligence? So if we know what is intelligence and how intelligence is generated and how intelligence is represented, then we can program a device to make it intelligent. But as of date, there is no standard definition for artificial intelligence. We don't have one universal definition for artificial intelligence. We have many definitions. We have many definitions because there are different school of thoughts with respect to intelligence itself. So we'll come back to that later. Before that, we'll discuss why this field is so fascinating. Why AI is so fascinating. So AI is fascinating because humans believe that we believe that we can create some super intelligent devices and which can what you call which can make our life much simplified. It is whatever a human does now, we can make a machine to do that. So artificial intelligence is ranked as the most interesting and fastest growing field, and it is already generating over trillions of dollars a year as revenue. As per the expert Kai-Fu Lee, he predicts that the AI will make such impact in the world. It will make such impact more than anything in the history of mankind. And the intellectual frontiers of AI are wide open. In the sense, you cannot say that AI is confined to computer engineers or AI is confined to data scientists. No. The scope is very huge. The field is open for the entire universe. And knowledge or expertise is required from different fields. Then only we'll be able to develop a full-fledged AI device. Okay, so AI spreads across a wide range. So we can say that so generally AI talks about learning, reasoning, perception, and so on. So these are the key aspects of intelligence. So intelligence itself comes from where? It is derived from humans. So humans are the most intelligent being which we know on the earth, right? So how a human develops his intelligence? It is basically by these three tasks. Perception means the humans perceive the environment. They observe the environment, right? So during perception, the humans are basically receiving inputs from the environment, and based on the inputs, we are reasoning. We are reasoning, like what is correct, what is wrong, or what is to be done, or what is not to be done, or which will profit me, which will create a loss for me. So that is reasoning. And then over a period of time, we learn. Sometimes something in the past, we might not be doing better, but down the line later we may be doing better because we learn over a period of time. So these are the general aspects of learning: perception, reasoning, and learning. So these are the general aspects of intelligence. But there are very specific tasks, such as playing a chess. So you may write a program which may not have any features of reasoning and learning, but still it can play an effective chess game. So this, if you write such a program, that is also considered as an AI program, but it is very much confined to a very small task. Proving mathematical theorems, writing a poetry, driving a car, diagnosing diseases. So like that, the list goes on. From general to specific. This is general, you can say all these are specific, right? So basically it's truly a universal field. So nobody can claim that AI belongs to only computer engineers or only data scientists. No, it's wide open. What is AI? How could we define AI? So before defining AI, we should know what is intelligence. We should know what is intelligence. Okay. So for with respect to intelligence itself, there are four schools of thoughts. There are four schools of thoughts with respect to intelligence among the scientific community. So what are those? Let us try to understand. So the school one says that the school one defines intelligence in terms of fidelity to human performance. Fidelity to human performance. That is, it says that intelligence is something like thinking like a human. If you are able to create a device, if you are able to make a device that thinks like a human, then you can say that is an intelligent device. Okay. So this is what school one says. School two, what it says in a sense. So all these are about intelligence. School two about intelligence. Intelligence is an abstract formal definition of intelligence called rationality. So school two says that it is more about rationality. Loosely speaking, doing the right thing, or you can say it is act rationally, right? So here there are two terms. When you compare the first definition and the second definition of intelligence, the first definition is think like a human. Okay, the second definition is act rationally. So the term to be considered is, here it is human, here it is rational. So what's the difference? Rational means doing the best thing. Okay, rational means doing the best thing. So does that mean that humans are irrational? So it does not mean that humans are irrational, but always humans don't do the best thing. Okay, we humans always we don't do the best thing. Always you may not give your best performance when you are facing an interview or when you are facing an exam. You may give your best performance, right? But when you are acting normally, you may not be giving the best. You may be acting in a very ordinary way, right? So that's what the first school of thought is about. It is thinking like a human, very naturally. Whereas the second school of thought says that if you want to create an AI device, and then that AI device should act rationally. That is, it should always try to optimize its results. It should always try to produce the best output. So if you create a device that always creates a best output, given the set of inputs, so given the set of constraints and the inputs, if it is always providing a best output, then you can say such a device as an artificial intelligent device. So that's what the school 2 says. School 3. What it says in the sense, it considers intelligence to be a property of internal thought process and reasoning. Internal thought process and reasoning. So basically, how the school three also it is also on talks about rationality, but it is more on thinking rational. It is more on thinking rational rather than acting rational. So what's the difference? The difference is, school 2 is concerned more on result. It is doing the right thing. The result should be optimal. The result should be best given this input. Whereas school 3 is, focus is not on the result. The focus is on the thought process. It is not like why that result. It is not like what is the result. Why is that result? So which set of events or which set of inferences has led to that result? So it focuses more on that. So that concept is called as thinking rationally. Okay. So this is school 4. School 4 focus on intelligent behavior and external characterization. So this is act like a human. School 1 is think like a human. That is you think like a human. But the thought process or how human makes judgment or how human inferences something when they encounter in real life. So it is more about the thought process and the judgment should be more humanly. This also does not bother about the result, but is the inference is like a human approach. That is what the school 1 says. But school 4 says that it focuses on result. Does the result is something like a human way? So is it like it is, will a human will produce this kind of result in this situation? So these are the 4 schools of thoughts with respect to intelligence. So depending on these 4 schools of thoughts, there are different definitions for AI available. Okay. So intelligence basically is of 2 dimensions, and with these 2 dimensions we have 4 combinations. What are the 2 dimensions? These 2 dimensions are humans versus rational. This is 1 dimension, human versus rational. One school of thought says that, if you see school 1 and school 4, it talks about human approaches. School 2 and school 3 talks about rational approaches. Again, school 1 and 4, it is about thought process, whereas school 4 is about action. In school 2 and 3, 2 is about action and 3 is about thought process. So dimension 1 is human versus rational, and dimension 2 is thoughts versus behavior or action. Okay. So these are the 2 dimensional. This is 1 dimension and this is another dimension. So for these 2 dimensions, we have 4 combinations. What are the 4 combinations? Think humanly, act humanly, think rationally, and act rationally. So these are the 4 dimensions. Okay. So fine. Okay. So So based on these 4 dimensions, these are some of the definitions which are given for AI by some experts. Okay. So first combination is systems that think like humans. Okay, so this is throughout the world, if you see, there are different group of scientists who are working on AI, and different group of scientists believe on a different philosophy. Some believe that an AI system should think like human. Some believe that an AI system should think rationally. Some believe that AI system should act like a human. And some believe that AI system should act rationally. Okay, so they are convinced in their own way, and they are working on their way. And sometimes the good results were also shared among all the scientists from different schools of thoughts. Okay, so as per this school of thought, AI is defined like this: the exciting new effort to make computers think. Machines with minds in the full and literal sense. So basically, this school of thought says that we would like to create machines with mind. Like how humans have mind, so mind is the one which creates thoughts. So we should create a machine which has mind. It should have a thinking faculty. So that is the objective. So they are more concerned about the thought process. The machines should be able to infer like how a human infers. So that is the objective. The second school of thought, systems that think rationally. Think rationally in the sense, it should think in a best possible way. Whereas here it's think like a human. Human always don't think in a best possible way. They think naturally, right? So it's a study of mental faculties through the use of computational models. So here your thought process should be always optimized. So if you are able to create such a machine, then these scientists believe that that is an AI machine. And the third school of thought says that systems that act like humans, so they are less bothered about thinking like humans. The system, we are not bothered about how the inferences are made, but what is the inference that we are bothered? What is the result? We are much bothered about the result, and is that result is much humanly? So that is what this school of thought says. Okay, the art of creating machines that perform functions that require intelligence when performed by people. So this is how they define. So normally there are certain acts which can be done by humans only because it needs intelligence. If such an act can be done by a machine, then we can claim that that is an artificial intelligence device. There is another definition: the study of how to make computers do things at which at the moment people are better. How could you create computers to do things at which at the moment people are better? So there are certain tasks which only humans can do. So if you can create a computer which can do that task, or if you can write a program which can do that task, then you can say that there is an artificial intelligent device. Okay. So based on the fourth school of thought, this is another definition. Computational intelligence is the study of the design of intelligent agents. AI is concerned with intelligent behavior in artifacts. Artifacts means artificial devices. If any artificial device is able to exhibit intelligent behavior, then we can call it as AI. It is more on creating intelligent agents. Agents means any electronic device. If that device has some intelligence, then you can call it as intelligent agents. Okay. So these are the different schools of thoughts about artificial intelligence, and these are the various definitions. And people are working in all the four areas. Okay. But as of today, we can say that AI is more into this, or AI has seen more success in this domain, systems that act rationally. So this is where AI has sensed some success. Okay, in this area, see, we have some examples. If you want me to quote. We have cameras that can understand human face, right? We have face recognition system. We can use face recognition system for marking attendance, or we can use face recognition system to ensure security. Okay, to ensure that the right person is entering into the room or office. All these things. Or we are using biometric system, so that is also a form of intelligence. So here we have achieved some success in this field. Okay. So now let us have a deep look on this four school of thoughts. So the first is thinking humanly. Thinking humanly is also called as cognitive modeling approach. Cognitive modeling means it is study of human brain. So that is a very, it's a special discipline, and it is also an interesting field. So basically they study like how human brain works, but that field is also very much connected with AI. Okay. So it is understanding human thoughts and an effort to build machines that emulate human thought process. So thinking humanly approach, again we are discussing these four school of thoughts in a detailed way. So in thinking human approach, it is to emulate a machine, it is to create a machine that emulate human thought process, Emulate means something which copies the human thought process. So this view is also called as the cognitive science approach to AI. So it mainly deals with introspection. We're trying to understand our own thoughts, psychological experiments, observing a person in action, and brain imaging. Like when you see something in the real world, how the brain changes, how the brain reacts, or with different inputs to a human, what are the changes happening in the brain patterns? Studying that and trying to incorporate that into a machine, and through that, if you want to achieve artificial intelligence, then such a technique is called as thinking humanly approach. So for example, for thinking humanly approach, this scientist Alan Newell and Herbert Simon, they developed a system called General Problem Solver. They created a system called General Problem Solver. Okay. So the interesting part of this is they were able to get solution for whatever the problem they created. They are able to get the solution, but they are not happy with the solution. They are not content merely the program giving correct outputs. Okay, they are not bothered about the output. What they are bothered is they were more concerned with comparing the sequence and timing of its reasoning to those of human subjects solving the same problem. They gave a problem to this particular program. The program was able to solve fine, but that is not their objective. Their objective is they gave the same problem to the humans also. When the human solved, like what type of steps and sequence a human followed and how much time they took for each of the steps and how they arrived at the result, is the machine is also using the same steps or not. So that is what their focus is on. So if they are able to create such a machine which is more likely to be a human like approach, human like sequence and timing, then they claim that is an AI device. Okay. So their focus is on it is not at all on the solution. It is on the sequence of steps and the timing. Is the machine, is the device, is also following the same sequence and similar timing as that of a human. So this field is very much connected with cognitive science. So in cognitive science, cognitive science is an interdisciplinary field which uses computer models from artificial intelligence, and also it uses experimental techniques from psychology to test theories of human mind. Okay, so basically it is a combination of artificial intelligence and psychology. That is the human mind or the human brain can be modeled by using AI, but again using some psychological techniques to test the theories on that. So this is an interesting field. You can further explore on this. So that's it about the first approach. The second approach is acting humanly. Acting humanly means the device should be able to act like a human. We are creating an intelligent device, and that intelligent device should act like a human. So how to ensure that? So actually, Turing has proposed a test for this, and this test is famously called as Turing test approach. Okay. So what Turing says is that he proposed this test, and he says that if a machine could pass this test, then we can say that we have successfully created an artificial intelligent device. So what is the test? The test is there will be a human interrogator. So this is a human. Okay. Now this human will post some questions. It is very generic questions. It can be anything. Okay.
It can be like something like, what's the time right now in US, or what is the weather right now in Delhi, or what is your name, or what is your age, or where you are working. Anything, anything, literally he can ask. Okay, there is nothing specific, but the answers will be given either by a human which is sitting in the another room or by the machine. From where the answer is coming, he don't know. This interrogator, actually he don't know from where he is getting the answer. He may get the answer either from the machine or from the human, and he should not be able to differentiate it. He should not be able to differentiate it. That is, he should not be able to differentiate that this answer is coming from machine or this answer is coming from a human. Like that, he should not be able to differentiate. He should be fooled such a way that every answer is coming from a human. Okay. So if you are able to create such a device, then we can claim that we have created an intelligent device, and such a device is said to be acting like a human. So in this case, this B is a machine. There is no human here. So if this could answer this person's questions successfully, and if it able to convince him that it is a human, then we can claim that we have created a machine which acts like human. Right? So this is what it says. So if you want to create such a machine, if you want to create such a machine, then what should be the features of that machine? If you want to create such a machine, then what should be the features of that machine? Then that machine should include all these features. It should have natural language processing capability. That is, it should be able to process natural language. Process natural language means humans speaks, right? Humans may speak English or Hindi or any other language. So when a human speaks such languages, the machine should be able to interpret it, and the machine should be able to process it, and it should be able to also communicate. Okay, either in written or in some other means. And we need some method to represent knowledge. How are we going to store knowledge? See, in case of humans, knowledge is stored in brain or mind. Okay, but if, when you want to create an intelligent device, how are you going to represent the knowledge? Where it will be, in what form we are going to represent? In conventional case, we use databases, we use rows and columns, all these things, but knowledge, how we are going to represent it? Okay. And then automated reasoning. Based on the questions that is posed or based on the environment, the device should be able to reason. The device should be able to analyze, and it should be able to act in the appropriate way, and it should draw conclusions. Okay. And machine learning. And it is not that the device should not be static. See, learning is one of the core aspects of intelligence. Without learning, we cannot call ourselves, or we cannot claim ourselves as intelligent being. So machine learning means adapting to new circumstances and to learn over a period of time. Okay. And also the device should have the ability for computer vision and speech recognition. And also it should include robotics. That is, it should be able to manipulate objects and it should be able to move. So improvement in all these fields are required: in natural language processing, knowledge representation, automated reasoning, machine learning, computer vision, and robotics. Only if a reasonable improvement happens in all these fields, we can create a machine which can pass the Turing test. Okay, then we can say that we have created a machine which acts like a human. Okay, and we can claim that as an artificial intelligent device. Right? That's about the second school of thought. The third school of thought is thinking rationally. So this approach, it focuses more on the laws of thought. That is it focuses only on whether the thought process is rational, whether the thought process is it in the best possible way. It does not focus on the result. It does focus on the sequence of steps. Is it more rational? Is it following a optimal approach at every step? So it emphasizes on inferencing mechanism and its properties, how the system arrives at a conclusion, or reasoning is very important. Is the reasoning is rational? So that is more important. Okay. So this approach can be programmed by using a concept called logic. So how can we capture this approach? So this can be captured in computers by using a technique called logic. So logic is basically one form of mathematical technique which was originally proposed by Aristotle. So Aristotle is the one who first proposed logic for successful reasoning. Okay. So these are some of the examples which is given by Aristotle. That is, Socrates is a man, all men are mortal. So these are two statements. Okay, Socrates is a man, it's one statement. All men are mortal is another statement. So Socrates is a mortal. So Socrates is mortal. So this is inference. So this two things are called as facts. Socrates is a man, this is a general fact. All men are mortal, this is a fact. Now from these two statements you can infer that Socrates is mortal, because all men are mortal, it's given here, and it's given that Socrates is a man. Okay. So this type of systems is called as logic. So logic means every step you follow logically. There is a reason, there is a perfect reasoning, which cannot be denied by anybody. That is, somebody cannot say that cannot happen. For example, say these two facts, this is 100% acceptable by everybody. If these two facts are 100% acceptable by everybody, then this also should be acceptable. Nobody can say that Socrates is immortal. Okay, so that is what is logic. So it follows that approach. So understanding logic and representing logic in the computers, so that is also one part of artificial intelligence. But the problem with this approach is, see, in the real world, we don't have 100% knowledge about everything. For example, we don't have 100% knowledge about politics or warfare, because these rules changes. There is no standard rules for certain things in the real world. For politics, there is no standard rules. For warfare, there is no standard rule. Okay, but there are standard rules for chess or arithmetic. So where there are standard rules which are fixed and which will never change, in such places logic is applicable. But if the rules are not standard, if they get change over a period of time, or if the rules are dynamic, then in that case, how could we do this thinking rationally approach? So here, for our rescue, probability is coming into picture. So when you don't have 100% fact, then you apply probability. Theory of probability fills this gap, allowing rigorous reasoning with uncertain information. So if you have certain information, then you apply logic. If you have uncertain information, then you go for theory of probability. Okay. So that's it about the third approach. And the fourth approach is acting rationally. So basically it involves creating rational agent. So it deals with building machines that act rationally. So the focus is on how the system acts and performs, and not so much on reasoning process. So here we are not into reasoning process, but we are more focused on the output. The output should be rational. The output should be optimal. Okay. So here we use the term called agent. What is an agent? An agent is something that acts. An agent is something that acts on the environment. It operates autonomously. That is, it operates by itself. It does not need anybody's guidance. It perceives the environment. It looks at the environment, it takes input from the environment, it persists, that is, it exists in the environment, it adapts to change, that is, over a period of time it learns, and it creates and pursues the goals. So anything is an agent, intelligent agents. For example, you can have a smart camera. We can call that as an agent. You can have a smart phone that can be called as an agent. So basically an agent is an electronic device that acts in the environment, that perceives the environment, and it has a specific objective, or it has a specific goal to achieve, right? And what is a rational agent? A rational agent is the one that acts rationally. That is, it acts in the best possible manner. That is, it always tries to optimize the result. That is, it always try to improve the utility. Right? Utility means the output. It always try to improve the value of the output. Okay. Fine. I think let us stop here for today's session. Thank you.